Amen. Ah, it's good to be together and to sing his praises. So good. Hey, thank you, team. Hey, grab your Bibles. We're going to be in Romans chapter 16, our next installment of the New Testament challenge. And I am so just anticipating what the Lord is going to do as we continue to read this following week once more throughout the New Testament. I hope that it has been encouraging your heart and your soul. But Romans 16, pull out your notes. They're in the center of the bulletin. You can also pull them up on the app. I want to welcome those on the live stream, those also that'll be viewing in the Foundry as well. So glad to have you guys all with us. Our online ministers are standing by. If you need to talk, the phone number's there. You can also DM them, comment, and they would love to follow up with you. Why the New Testament challenge? So I was having lunch with a dear friend this past week, and as we were eating, he was telling me how much he's enjoying being immersed in the Word and reading such large segments of the Scriptures. And as he's telling me this, he gets to the end, and he goes, but Chris, why the New Testament challenge? Why have we begun this? And so really, just kind of sharing my heart with him, I started to share. As someone, you begin to work out, I know many of you guys took on a New Year's resolution. Maybe you're going to work out, you're going to eat better, you're going to get healthy, right? Okay, maybe some of you guys are already done with that. It is halfway to February, right? But I said, you know, here's what's an interesting thing that happens physically, even mentally and emotionally, as you begin to work out, as you begin to eat right, as you begin to input the right stuff into your body, what happens is, at least after a period of time of maybe going through withdrawals, you begin to feel better. You have greater energy. Some of you will even begin to shed excess weight, or some of you, as I know at the gym I work out, as people have gotten healthier, they begin to get rid of certain medications, maybe for blood pressure or for high blood sugar or a whole host of different sort of medications. As they begin to get healthy, you begin to input the right things and you feel better and you just become better. And so I was telling my friend, I said, it's similar with the Word. When we begin to input the Word of God inside of us, the Holy Scriptures, the infallible, inerrant, Holy Scriptures that are God-breathed, as we begin to input them into our life, into our mind, and into our heart, they begin to refresh us and to renew our minds. We begin to abide in Christ in a way, in a manner that we have never done before. We become more fulfilled and fruitful as we're immersed in the Scriptures. We feel better even emotionally, because as we grow in, well, our walk in relationship with the Lord, we grow in holiness. And holiness, as we know, equals wholeness. We grow more whole as we grow holy. And we may even shed some of our pet sins that keep us down. We begin to see our relationships improve. And I said, brother, this is why we're doing the New Testament challenge, because this is what I want for our church. I want us to walk in a deep, intimate, fruitful, and fulfilling relationship with the Lord Christ. And that only comes by spending copious amounts of time with him. Because, my friends, I want holiness and wholeness for all of you all. Wholeness in health, wholeness in mental health, wholeness in physical health, wholeness in emotional health, wholeness in spiritual health. And so this is why the New Testament challenge. You see, we need to be immersed in truth because we live in a day filled with lies. We need truth so badly in our day and age. We need straight, unvarnished truth from the Lord God to fill our hearts and our minds so we can do as Paul says in Romans, to be renewed by the renewing, refreshed by the renewing of our minds as we read the Word. My friends, we need truth because there, you all know, there's so many partial truths out there, aren't there? And what's a partial truth? It's a lie sugar-coated by the enemy to make it a little bit more palatable for you and I. It simply lies out there. There's so many lies floating around. It's hard to know what to believe, isn't it? It's hard to know who to believe. I mean, which news source do you believe? I'll be honest. They seem like they're all a bunch of liars. Which leaves you and me confused, scared, angry, nervous, anxious, empty. Think about all the lies that fly from politicians' mouths. Maybe they've always lied. We just know all about it now. For crying out loud, we've just caught one of the Supreme Court justices make up facts to fit their agenda in the past couple of weeks. You can't even trust the Supreme Court justice to give us real facts? Or all the partial truths about this or that? And I don't know, we're all left wondering what's right. No wonder we're the most anxious people on the planet. And we can point to a lot of examples and a lot of reasons for this, but I want to zoom in on one for just this morning. I want to zoom in on how our postmodern deconstruction of truth has come to roost through social media. I mean, you got to understand something about this. We are thinkers as believers, right? We have the redeemed mind of God. We are individuals who think. We don't react emotionally. We keep our emotions tethered to the truth of Scripture, not the other way around. And so while we look at this postmodern deconstruction of truth and how it is running rampant on social media, you got to understand the people who built these platforms did so with a post-enlightenment, post-modern, post-church belief about truth. The individuals who put these social medias together that we all spend so much time on, well, they did it with a worldview that is anti-biblical, anti-Christ, anti-God. It's in a post-enlightenment, post-church, post-modern worldview. And here's what that means. It means that, well, truth is individual. It's preferential. Perhaps it's indeterminate. In theatrical terms, their view of truth would be anything is theater as long as it's theater to you. And you get to write the script. You get to produce your play of one, which is, well, it makes you out to be the sovereign. But now, here's what's interesting. After decades of being raised within this worldview, I praise God for our younger generation, by the way. Our younger generations, the one who built Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest and the others, they're realizing that truth does count for something, and that not having some basis of truth is actually ripping us apart. Aren't you glad they discovered that finally? And that's what Netflix's documentary called The Social Dilemma is all about. It's mostly interviews with key designers of artificial intelligence and these designers of the social media platforms that are now saying, in essence, we created algorithms that we no longer control. They're controlling us. If Adam Smith described capitalism as the invisible hand that guides and directs our economy, however imperfectly, it's as if social media is now our new invisible hand. And what is it creating? Confusion, fear, anxiety, worry. Friends, am I wrong? Am I wrong? I mean, this documentary is a fascinating study, not only on the severe harms and the unintended consequences of the digital age, but it's quietly and a confession. My friends, understand this. Truth matters, and we can no longer deny it. Do you understand that? Truth matters, and we can no longer deny it. Here's what one expert said, and it's right there in the trailer. If everyone is entitled to their own facts, to their own truths, then there's really no need to come together. I want to play a trailer, and I want you to see for yourselves from the mouths of the designers.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests.
That's not by accident, that's a design technique.
What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded.
A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook-like button.
I was the president of Pinterest.
Google.
Twitter.
Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms. I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
We get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up, and we conflate that with value, and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real-world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news.
We're being bombarded with rumors.
If everyone's entitled to their own facts, there's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
So for those of you that are interested, on February 20th at each of the campuses at 4 o'clock, I believe, we're going to have a showing, a viewing of The Social Dilemma. Show up, we'll have some pop and popcorn, and we will sit back and watch, and we'll use the gray matter that the Lord has given us to be critical thinkers about the things that are taking place in our world and how we use them and take part in them. So mark your calendars. But my friends, this right here is where the church shines. It is in this confusion and this chaos and these days of high anxiety and worry, this time of uncertainty, that the church shines. It's where the church can be better, has been better, and must be better. And this is what I love about what we are calling the New Testament Challenge that so many of you have committed yourselves to. It's to the grounding and the anchoring and the deepening and the full immersion into God's eternal truths contained in the Bible. Because, my friends, when we read the Bible and we really let it sink in, here's what we learn. Look at your notes there. Here's what you will understand as we begin to see the overall meta-narrative of the Scriptures. You're going to see there is one script. This is one story from Genesis to Revelation, 66 books. It's one story about the redemption of mankind by the Lord God through His Son, Jesus Christ. There's one director. Really, it's one Lord, Jesus. There's one cast. Oh, friends, there's one cast. Guess what? It's the church. It's you and I. We are the cast that gets to play a massive role in the outworkings of the Creator on this planet. And yet for centuries, the church has had to fight against confusion from the very beginning. And so this is our fight. Truth versus lies of the enemy. This is what he does. And the church... well, friends, this is who we are. 1 Corinthians 13:1, and yet for centuries, the church has to fight against this just amazing just background of noise. And what do we learn in 1 Corinthians 13? That it's love. Who cares what's being said if it's not done through love and for the purposes of love? You're going to read in Galatians this week. By the way, I hope you're staying up with us. I hope you're continuing. Hope you're caught up. You've got the rest of the day to finish the book of Acts. Man, what a book, by the way. So good. But you're going to read in Galatians this week, and Paul, he addresses this very such thing to the churches in Galatia who were grappling with these outside voices telling this young community of Gentiles that they had to first become Jews before they could become Christ followers. A blatant lie couched in a bit of, well, Jewish truth, and the Galatian church didn't know what to do about it. And so Paul comes in with clarity, as the church should always speak with clarity, and tells the truth. because that's who we are. By the way, Paul is so upset. I mean, he is hacked off about this whole idea that these individuals must become Jews before they become Christ followers. I mean, he has had it up to here. And my friends, it is going to take the holy people of God to arise amongst themselves a holy anger to say, no more of this. We're not going to allow it to prey particularly upon our young people and upon those folks within our church family and our communities. We're going to stand up and we're going to tell the truth about these things. We're going to do it in love. We're going to do it in grace. But we're going to make sure people understand. And so Paul, in no uncertain terms, he calls these people agitators. Oh, friends, do we have agitators today? He goes on to say in Galatians, they're not harmonious with the heart of God. Here's what he says in Galatians. I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will adopt no other view, but the one who is disturbing you will bear his judgment, whoever it is. And you'll also be reading Romans this week, a phenomenal book, which is just quite the doozy of a letter. In Rome, there was also confusion because the Gentiles and the Jews couldn't get along in the church at Rome. Emperor Claudius, he expelled the Jews out of the city, and then once the Jews had to leave the city, the Gentiles began to run the church. It wasn't until 5 years later that the Jews were allowed back into Rome, and then they began to, well, gather back inside the body of Christ, the local church there. And when they did, they found that the foreigners, the Gentiles, were in charge, and the church looked different. And so they had confusion on their hands. Isn't it amazing how experiencing peace and standing on truth and not being allowed to slide into trouble has always been a challenge in the church? You know why that is? Because we're all human. And it's a spiritual battle. There truly is nothing new under the sun. But here's the good news. By the power of God, the church has always found a way to move towards truth, not just aspirationally, but in actuality. So to illustrate this, I want us to look to the book of Romans, Romans chapter 16 together, including all of its salutations, all the people that he greets. I don't know, maybe you're like me, and sometimes you get to these sections where there's just a bunch of genealogies and lists of names. You're like, skip, I'm going to read something deep. I'm going to read something more weighty and theological. And so you skip those. You skip part of the Old Testament. You skip part of the Gospels. But I want you to remember that there is nothing in all of Scripture that does not in some way have meaning and divine intent for you and I. Here and now today. So let's jump in. Here's how Paul begins his concluding remarks to the book of Romans. Now, you're going to read it. You're going to read it this week. Let me whet your appetite to read over the next 5 days. Are you ready? Let's stand and read the Word of God. Romans 16. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea, that you receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and that you help her in whatever matter she may have need of you. For she herself has been a helper of many and of myself as well. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who for my life risked their own necks, to whom not only do I give thanks, but also the churches of the Gentiles. Also greet the church that is in their house. Greet Epaphroditus, my beloved, who is the first convert to Christ from Asia. Greet Mary, who has worked hard for you. Greet Andronicus and Junius, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are outstanding among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Greet Ampliatus, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and Stachys, my beloved. Greet Apollos, the approved in Christ. Greet those who are of the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodian, my kinsman. Greet those of the household of Narcissus, who are in the Lord. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, workers in the Lord. Greet Persis, the beloved, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, a choice man in the Lord, also his mother and mine. Greet Ensencritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Patrobus, Hermas, and the brethren with them. Greet Philologus and Julia, Nereus and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you. Now I urge you, brethren, keep your eye on those who cause dissensions and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned, and turn away from them. For such men are slaves, not of our Lord Jesus, but of their own appetites. And by their smooth and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. For the report of your obedience has reached to all. Therefore, I am rejoicing over you. But I want you to be wise in what is good and innocent in what is evil. The good of God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. Timothy, my fellow worker, greets you, and so do Lucius and Jason and Sosipater and my kinsmen. I, Tertius, who write this letter, greet you in the Lord. Gaius, host to me, and to the whole church greets you. Erastus, the city treasurer, greets you. And Cordus, the brother, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which has been kept secret for long ages past, but now is manifested, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the eternal God, has been made known to all the nations, leading to obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. Father, bless the reading of your word. Enlighten our minds by the Holy Spirit. Have your way within us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Man, this is so cool. This is just so awesome. This letter then closes out with Phoebe. So Phoebe is a lady who actually carried the letter of Paul, a very trustworthy position to be honored with. And so essentially he says, hey, take my letter to the church at Rome. I'm vouching for you. Take it and give it to the church to be read amongst all the brethren. I mean, they had fake news in their day too, by the way. Many people would come and say, hey, I got a letter from Paul. Got a letter from Paul. Got a letter from Paul. Hey, Paul said this. But no, here in this case, Paul is vouching for Phoebe. He's extending his authority to her. And then she would stick around as they would read this letter, perhaps even help in the training of the believers there. She is most likely a woman of means, a benefactor who performed a really important function in the life of the early church. I mean, it's super cool. It's super cool. Then Paul goes on to greet 26 people in the church in Rome, 24 of them by the first name. And we just read all those greetings there. Now before I continue, I want to say a couple of things here. Just a couple of very important theological things with great theological significance and ramifications. One, if you are about to have a child soon, there are some really cool and exotic baby names in here. I mean, just think about it. That's my boy Andronicus. Yeah. Get you some Erastus. Olympus. I mean, just some cool names. Rufus. Maybe if you're from the South. I don't know. Secondly, another little tip, just to be helpful. As you noticed, I read rather quickly. Even someone with 10 years of seminary training, I read quickly. So if you were to point out I said it wrong, I'd say, well, you simply have misunderstood me. The main thing to do when reading genealogies is go great confidence, great speed. Works every time. But let's get on with it. Paul then turns to some more names, this time from the ones he's writing on behalf of. He's already said that all the churches greet you, which is to remind the church in Rome that they are a part of something so much larger. You know, it's easy at times to think we're just a part of maybe a small body of believers in our community or our city. I was reminded in a fantastic way that we are a part of the capital C church this past week. It's literally hundreds and hundreds of text messages and calls and emails and social media messages came through from people literally all over the globe saying they're praying for my dad. It was such a wonderful display of the church being the church. My friends, we are not just part of Fellowship Church. We are part of the Lord Jesus Christ Church that is pushing back darkness, saving souls, bringing holiness and healing to people all over the globe. We are a part of the church, amen? And so now, I want to look at verse 21 here. Timothy, my fellow worker, greets you. So do Lucius and Jason and Sosipater, my kinsmen. I, Tertius, who write this letter, greet you in the Lord. Gaius, host to me, and the whole church greets you. Erastus, the city treasurer, greets you. And Cordus, the brother. So look at this. So many names. But I want to look at three aspects of a unified church. As you read this week, As you read the scriptures, I want you to capture a vision of the unified church and what the Lord does through the church when it's unified, and how beautiful it is and how attractional it is. And so you look here, even at what we just read, a lot of names. I mean, he clearly doesn't say them all. I mean, that's a little dangerous, isn't it? Have you ever gotten stuck in public thanking a few people, and before long, you're like, I forgot who else to thank, and then you get nervous you're going to leave somebody out? It only happens to me. I could imagine his scribe saying, Paul, really? Do you want to name them all? Can't I just put to the church? I mean, this is giving my hand a cramp. It sounds like just a long list of jumbled names, when in fact, what we see here is the beauty of the church. Look at your notes here. I want you to see this. The first aspect of the unified church is unity only happens through diversity. When you drill down into the names, here's what you begin to see. As you begin to look at the names, you're going to see these are Jewish names. Aquila and Priscilla, for example. These are Gentile names. Some of these names are common slave names, like Ampliatus and Urbanus and Hermes and Philologus and Julia. These are slaves. Some of these names are at least associated with the higher societal rank and mean. Aristobulus. I mean, that sounds pretty aristocratic, doesn't it? I mean, you want a highbrow name for your kid, go with Aristobulus. I mean, he was considered by church historians the grandson of King Herod the Great, and he was a friend of Emperor Claudius. That's who this young man is. Some carry great significance in the story of Christ. Rufus is speculated as being the son of Simon the Cyrene, who carried Jesus' cross. But most fascinating is Paul's greetings to women. 9 out of the 26 persons that he lists here are female. And when you drill down into the Greek, you see a strong advocacy on behalf of women that would have turned a few heads back in Jesus' day and in Jesus' time. And perhaps, depending on the church you're at, today might turn a few heads. So please take this in. What we see through this list of names is Jews and Gentiles, slave and free, male and female. Does that sound familiar? That's the church. And the beauty and the diversity of the church. Look at what Paul says in Galatians. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. I mean, come on! It doesn't get any better than that. Paul's not speaking aspirationally, like this is what we aspire to be as the church. This is what we hope to one day be as the church. He's speaking in actuality. I mean, sure, there's challenges, right? But I mean, where is there not challenges in this life? What happened in the Roman church, and in fact, in every church around the Mediterranean area, was this radically turning in their day because people were categorized and classified by wealth and race and status and ability and every such thing. And don't you love it when we come into the church? We're just known as brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so. We are the family of God in Christ. So glad it's not like the church that first settled in even this nation, where the rich would pay the big pew rents up front. And well, us poor mongers would sit back on a split rail on the back wall. And the church is beautiful in its diversity. You look around our church, we say we're a church of all generations. The diversity of ages across our church is a beautiful thing. It's a testimony that the Lord saves all. But see, God was writing something new. And the church was designed to play it. That's what we're going to read this week, is you're going to see this new design that God has called the church, and how you and I, well, we are the church, and we're going to see what God has called us to. And so unity only happens through diversity. So glad we're not an us for no more church. So glad that we are a church with different backgrounds, socioeconomic statuses, different experiences. Can you imagine if we all were just this monolithic, same sort of people? Boring. But unity through diversity is really the only way that truth and peace can come. You can't harmonize if you're all singing the same tune. You can't create a symphony if you're all playing the same instrument. Diversity is in our church's DNA from the very beginning, and that wonderful diversity happened through relationships. Listen to this. Paul had a relationship with these people, and they clearly had a relationship with one another. It seems that Paul references, a house church, which would be similar to our Sunday school classes, six times in this passage, which is beautiful because God is relational at his very core, his Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There's nothing transactional about the grace of God, nothing transactional about the love of the Father, nothing transactional about the salvation of his Son, nor about how we live together in community. It's always relational. We are a family united under, the lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ from different backgrounds. And so unity only happens through diversity. Number two, what we see here is unity only happens when we all submit to Jesus. Unity only happens when we all submit to Jesus. And so he's the director. Not you, not me. That means he calls the shots, not you, not me. He picks the lyrics that we sing and the words that we study. Not you, not me. If you're trying to play from your own scorebook, or if you're only trying to play what you think should be played, that's confusion. And confusion leads to fear. Leads to fighting. It's what we see leading churches to death all over this great nation. Unity. The conductor, the producer, the director, he's not any other figure, affiliation, affinity group, ideology, or political persuasion. No, we fall under the lordship of our producer, director, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our guide. He's laid it out for us in his word. Paul constantly reminds the church in Rome that they are to follow his lead. He literally says four times that they are in Christ and five times in the Lord. And so, my friends, we will only have unity when we all submit to Christ. How do we submit to Christ? We deny self. We obey the scriptures, we follow his example, and when we all do that in unison with this great diversity of ages and backgrounds and even ethnicities and socioeconomic backgrounds, what happens is we put on a theatrical display of his attributes to the world that they can't seem to get over because it's not normal, it's unnatural, because the church is what? Supernatural. Number three, unity only happens when we each use our God-given shape. So we talk a lot about our God-given shape. You know, if you've been through our growth steps, in step two, we really lean into this in that seminar, that we all have spiritual gifts and heart passions and abilities and past experiences and life experience, professional experiences, life experiences, and all of those together make our God-given shape. You will never truly understand who you are in Christ until you understand how he's made you and created you. And all of those five aspects of your life story come together when you come to faith in Christ, and that's who he's made you to be. And unity really only happens when we each use our God-given shape. I love how Paul uses specific names because, people were accountable for playing their part. There were scribes, there were letter carriers, there were trainers, there were disciples, there were teachers, people in places of high position, people in places of low position, those who risked their own lives, those who had worked very hard. And so if I were to write a letter to Fellowship Church and I wanted to commission you and charge you to important matters, I would use your names too. I'd say, church, this is what God has called us to do. I said, this is what we're going to do. I would say, Tyler and Alyssa, this is what we're called to do. I would say, Barry, this is what we're called to do. I would say, Sean, this is it. Get with it over here. I would say, this is what we're doing. I'd say, Bobby, Jackie, this is it. This is your part. You're being held accountable to this. We would call out specific names because there's accountability there. And then, just to cover all my bases, when I got done, I would say, then everyone greet one another with a holy kiss. No? Probably not wise in this COVID era. Something happens, doesn't it? Something happens when you hear your name. Something rises up within you. You snap to a different attention, and you're reminded that Paul is saying, here's the script. Jesus is the director, and we are all in the play. I'll never forget it, man. As a kid in elementary school, I mean, I was a phenomenal student, I'm sure. Prove me wrong. But on occasion, the teacher would say, Chris Williams, and I don't know what I was doing, but guess what I would do? I would pop to attention. Yes, ma'am. And she would say, answer the question. I'd just say whatever came to my mind, confidence and speed. And she'd say, to the office, young man. Again, going there to be an encouragement to his soul. But you know, when you hear your name, you snap to a different attention. Church, I want you to hear your name this morning. The Lord God is calling you to play your part within his church. You are part of the play. You are invaluable to it all. Who is going to pick up after the director of the Lord Jesus Christ when he says, okay, let's start from the top all together now. We're all ready now to take part in our play. I heard this story from a pastor friend. There's a guy named Fabio in Italy. Now, not the Fabio with the long hair and the, well, it's like butter sort of commercials, but a real Fabio. And so Fabio was a musician, and he loved the Foo Fighters. He lived in Cesena, Italy. It's really a phenomenal thing. You can see it on YouTube if you'd like to watch it. So Fabio wanted the Foo Fighters to come to his little city of Italy and to play a concert. Well, you know, you don't just get the Foo Fighters to come to your little town in Italy to play in the fields a concert. And so he said, I'm going to get their attention. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put out a call across the nation of Italy to come and to bring your instruments, and I'm going to put the biggest band together that the planet has ever seen. And he masses out in a field. He gets a scaffolding two or three stories high. He's on top of this scaffolding. There is hundreds of drummers setting up their drum sets. You would love it, brother. You would love it. Then there was hundreds of bassists, hundreds of guitarists, hundreds of flutists or flautists. There was hundreds of all sorts of things, harps and lyres and other sorts of things. I'm not musical, okay? I'm just going with it. But thousands upon thousands of musicians and singers filled this meadow. And they began to sing the Foo Fighter song, whatever song that was. And they recorded it and put it on YouTube, and it got attention all over the world. And the lead singer saw the video and literally started to cry that someone would care enough about his art, his music, to do this. And he said, I want to go there and play. And his label said, well, we'll add it to the tour. He goes, no, we're going tomorrow. And the very next day, they showed up. But here's why I want to point it out. Here's what's so beautiful about it. Tens of thousands of people playing all sorts of different instruments, all different ages, all different ethnicities, all different socioeconomic backgrounds, making a beautiful noise that made the Foo Fighters stop in their tracks, pay attention, and say, I want to be a part of that. My friends, that's the church. That's the local church of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we're all playing our part, when we're all leaning into our gifts, when we're all putting his attributes on display in our lives, and it's this multicultural, multi-generational, multi-socioeconomic background group. It puts the world on notice, and they say, I don't know about that, but I want to be a part of it. Amen. Friends, that's the church, and you and I are a part of it. Hallelujah. Yes. It's the church. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture of heaven, what we see there in Cesena, Italy. If you thought heaven would be boring, just watch the video. It's literally how the end of the story gets told. Revelation 7, verse 10. They cry out with a loud voice saying, salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Perfect unity and diversity. People from every nation, tribe, and tongue. And listen, get this. We don't have to wait for that day. We can live it now. Matthew 6:10 says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We can put him on display now. We're unified in diversity. We're unified as we submit to the Lord. We are unified when we use our God-given shape. It could be a drummer. It could be a technician. It could be a stagehand. It could be someone that fills coffee. It could be someone who gathers the offering. It could be someone who serves outside our four walls. Maybe the Lord is calling you to play a role today. Maybe it's you need to join a Sunday school class and to get involved in a body life of our church and really to do life with a group of individuals. Maybe the Lord is calling you to take part in fostering and adoption right now to get in and to rescue these little ones without moms or dads. Maybe the Lord is calling you to unify and submit to your shape by telling someone that you love Jesus and tell them about your story and your testimony. Maybe it's about you reconciling and forgiving. Maybe it's you serving your next door neighbor or someone here at our church. My friend, I want you to hear me. We are not the same without you. You bring a unique, cool, beautiful, spirit-filled vibe about you because, well, you matter and this matters. Look at Romans 16 again. Did you read the names and understand it? This truth we just talked about, it mattered to Narcissus' household. It mattered to Nereus' sister. It mattered to Rufus' mother. It mattered to Erastus and his work there at the public works office. It matters in the prison. It mattered in the church. And it matters to the world. Church, it is our time to stand tall, unified in the Lord Jesus Christ, putting his attributes on display with all of our failings and shortcomings and sin, giving grace to one another, loving one another, and well, simply putting him on display for all to see. And so as you consider this, as you consider to live into this and stand in this, I want you to stand with me, and I want us to out loud to conclude with his doxology that he gives us in verse 25. Let's say it together with gusto now, unto the Lord. He's up here. All together now. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which has been kept secret for long ages past, but now is manifested, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the eternal God, has been made known to all the nations, leading to obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. So here's what I want us to do as we remain standing. The Lord has given us a super tangible reminder that we are one body, one church, under the lordship of one Lord Christ. It's called the Lord's Supper. So we're gonna go ahead and get your Lord's Supper elements ready to go. He's given us the bread to remind ourselves that he gave his body a sacrifice. He's given us the juice to remind us that he gave his blood, the unblemished Lamb of God, to wash away our sins. If you need one, raise your hand. Our ushers are available. We need some down front. Here's what I want you to do now. I want you to take a moment and to ponder what unity in the church means according to Paul and what part you play in it. And as you do, prepare your heart to partake of these elements. Remember, you don't have to be a member of Fellowship Church to partake of the Lord's Supper here, but you do have to be a member of the church. You have to be a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, walking in obedience. If that's not you, simply let this pass, set it aside. If there's some things going on maybe that you want to get right with someone, well, get it right with them and set it aside. Or maybe it's something you simply need to confess to the Lord, repent, and receive his forgiveness and grace now. You can do that. But for a moment now, ponder unity in the church and your part in that. Receive his forgiveness, and we'll be prepared to partake in just a moment. Thank you. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. While they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." Let's remember, the Lord Jesus Christ gave his body a sacrifice to purchase his church. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for forgiveness of sins." Let's remember, he spilt his unblemished, perfect blood for the forgiveness of our sins. We're going to continue to worship here. Perhaps you're here this morning and you've yet to give your life to Christ. Maybe you heard something that piqued your interest. The Spirit of God speaking to you. I'd love to speak with you in just a moment down here. Or you find us after the service. Or you can highlight there on that little card in the seat back in front of you. You want to talk to a pastor and drop that in the boxes. Man, we don't want you to leave here without having your questions answered. But church family, think about it. The God of the universe stepped out of creation into this sinful, broken world to bring healing and wholeness through the death, burial, and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. He's purchased his church. Our calling is to be unified in him and to put his attributes on display. What a calling that is, my friends. Let's lean into that calling. Let's worship. I'll be right here.